Hey, what's up? This is Miss Vimbai, and you are locked into Two Broke Twimbos. I hope they get paid soon.
We ain't got it. Broke, fat broke. We ain't got it.
Don't spend no money. Ain't got no clothes. Ain't got no cars. Ain't got no hoes. We broke.
Ladies and gentlemen.
We're now listening.
And we're good.
All right, guys, it's your boy, Phil Chart, a.k.a. Flint Floss, the big boss, baby. A.k.a.
Feeds a P.
A.k.a. Sexington Lovu. A.k.a. Filthy Phil. A.k.a. Shamari, the Tengero drink. And I'm here. Some might say Zimbabwe's most popular export. I mean, she's done quite a lot for herself. She's a reality TV star. She's a host.
Uh-huh.
Brand ambassador.
Yeah.
Some might even say an attraction within herself, really. None other than the lovely, vivacious.
Really vivacious?
Yes, yes.
We took it there.
I know, you know, I've been reading the thesaurus. So, you know,
exactly.
You know, we're just trying to impress people with these big words, you know. The lovely Vimbai Mutinari. So, how are you doing, ma'am?
Do you know there's nothing more awkward than being introduced?
Really?
Yes, it is so awkward. Because what are you supposed to do with yourself during... Have you seen those memes of the faces of pastors while they're being introduced before they step onto the pulpit? Like, all you can do is, like, look down or maybe look around the room. Just act like you're not arrogant. No, act like you're not enjoying
There's
it.
There's no one here, so you can take it all in. You know.
And you're here. You're going to leave here and be
I'm
like,
not even
oh,
looking. I'm looking,
that girl was feeling herself.
No, you know, it's fine. You know what? I'm of the opinion, if you work hard enough,
mm-hmm.
when the praise comes, you should accept it. I mean, the people weren't there when you were shooting in the gym. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So you should accept it. You work pretty hard.
Yeah, I've worked my butt off.
In fact, let me put it this way. One thing that's always impressed me about you is I don't really watch reality TV.
Uh-huh.
But I catch glimpses here and there. So I knew you on Big Brother.
Yes.
But if I look back at it and we say Zimbabweans that were on Big Brother.
Mm-hmm.
Even if you say Africans that were on Big Brother,
mm-hmm.
what have they done since they had the opportunity at that platform?
Yeah.
What vision did they have? If they had a plan, how did they implement it? What have they done with their careers?
Yeah.
With you, it's a very discernible part. Like, it's very clear you went in with a plan and you executed that to a T.
Yeah.
Who else is still standing?
Well, you know what? I don't think it's fair to say that because not everybody has decided to pursue public careers.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm pretty sure that there are housemates, ex-housemates out there who are doing really well,
mm-hmm.
but have decided to shy away from, you know, the public forum, mm-hmm. because Big Brother itself is fine. Post Big Brother is actually a very traumatizing time of your life.
That is important.
Yeah, the expectations are so high. You know, everybody wants you to be something that you may not be. So, that's really tough. So I can understand when a lot of people just decide that entertainment may not be for them. And I know Itai, he's doing really well. I hear he's a banker.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I hear that he's a very successful, established banker.
Yeah.
So actually, he's still standing.
I grew up with Itai.
You grew up with him, right?
We're both Mutari boys, yeah.
He lives in the US, right?
Yeah, he recently relocated. I think he had family there already.
Uh-huh.
So
the guy is standing.
But you get what I'm saying. You can see that there are individuals that... did try to pursue something within the public eye and use that momentum.
Yeah.
But along the way, things might have gone right. I'm not going to point fingers. And you gave a very good answer that some people might not have felt that was the choice for them. That was the career path they wanted.
Yeah.
But to me, it's impressive.
Yeah.
Especially as a Zimbabwean who does a lot of stuff within Africa.
Yeah.
I see how hard it is for a Zimbabwean to get recognition outside of Zimbabwe.
Yeah.
So for you to do that, it's doubly more impressive to me.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, no, it's hard out here. Tough out here. It's really tough. But I think, you know what, just kind of referring back to, because I've been involved in a lot of conversations lately. And I mean, these are ongoing conversations about, you know, what's it going to take for Zimbabweans to get noticed or for Zimbabwean artists to break out and whatever it is. And, you know, this is probably slightly controversial, but I think it's to stop thinking about being Zimbabwean. For me, probably the greatest push was to stop thinking of myself as a Zimbabwean or as a non-South African or as a non-Nigerian or a non-Kenyan. I just looked at myself as an African product in entertainment who could make it anywhere. So I think once the entertainment industry generally in Zimbabwe kind of stops looking at themselves as Zimbabweans or as peculiar and realizes that entertainment is a business that has a format across the world. Mm-hmm. And as long as you follow the format, there's rules, there's things that work. Yeah. There's a, I mean, look at you, you're doing this and you're getting there. Do you know what I mean? You're actually doing some pretty major stuff. You are. Well done. I'm very proud of you. I'm very proud of you.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Actually, yeah, you lead into a very good point. We've been having this discussion on the African Hip Hop blog for a while. Like,
yeah.
I did a series of posts as to why Zimbabweans are struggling. And that was my sentiment.
Yeah.
If you look at Zimbabwe, especially, there's no distribution network anymore. They mm-hmm. can't sell a CD because piracy is just going to overrun you.
Yeah.
So if you look at the amount of Zimbabweans online,
yeah,
you may, at most, you're probably going to reach maybe 100, 200,000 people.
Yes.
But Africa has a population approaching a billion.
Yes.
So you're better off appealing to the continent and maybe getting 10% of the continent than focusing on trying to get 40% of Zimbabwe.
Yeah. True, but I think it's important to also begin with a very solid following, a solid mm-hmm. foundation where you come from. So if you look at all of the most successful, if we're talking hip-hop, I don't know that much about hip-hop, but if you're talking about artists, musicians in general, the most successful ones are the ones who have a very solid fan base where they come from.
Exactly.
And that usually kind of propels you forward. But you first need to stand for something and be about something, and then naturally and organically there's going to be a group of people who are about that same thing and rep so hard for you. And when you're so authentic, yo man, everybody's just gonna bow down and respect, even if we don't understand what language you're rapping in or singing in. Exactly. Or whatever, if it's real, it's real, and everybody likes something real.
And that's the most important thing, being authentic and being real. If you're copying the next guy, why would people buy a cheap imitation when you get the original for the same price?
Exactly. Yeah.
We got sidetracked.
Yeah, sorry. I'm so random today, but I'm generally random, but this I'm one, enjoying
this,
conversating.
This podcast has really no format. Our listeners are used to just anything going.
Cool.
So I think let's rewind it and go back.
Okay.
To a young Vimbai. Did you, as a kid, did you ever have dreams? Is this what you wanted to be when you grew up?
Definitely. I knew that this is what I wanted to do. I wasn't specifically sure about which avenue in entertainment I would mm-hmm. take. I used to fancy myself quite a singer.
Oh yes. If I recall.
Don't say it. I forbid you. I'll pinch you. Phil, I'll pinch you. I reject it.
Yes, I think it was track 8. Was it track 8 or track 9?
I don't know what you're talking about. All I know
Your name is there.
No, it must be some other Vimbai.
Really? There's another Vimbai Mutinari?
Yes.
Featuring Reverb 7?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, must be. Yo, man, that was a moment. But that was like that post-Big Brother chaos that mm-hmm. just makes you do all kinds of nonsense while you're finding yourself. But going back to being a young Vimbai, because apparently I've been, you know, getting lost in this interview. I knew I wanted to be in entertainment. I knew it was my calling. I knew it was my purpose. Many things happened along the way, but I still found my way back here. But growing up, I always tell the story. I used to watch Miss World. I used to try and learn Janet Jackson's dance routines. Mm-hmm. I was just particularly intrigued by the world of entertainment. So it was only natural that I ended up here. Okay. Yeah.
Any variety shows?
So many. Oh my goodness. I was that kid. You know, you've got that kid in class at school who's always like trying to volunteer for everything. Like they want to do the play, then they want to sing, then they want to dance, then they want to MC the variety show. I was that kid.
Oh, the annoying one.
Yes. I was annoying though. I was. I probably still am, but I'm famous now, so nobody cares. Ha!
Shut up. So wait, which high school was this? Which high school were you?
Geez, I went to a number, but the ones I spent the most time at were Arundel and Peterhouse.
Ah, okay.
I was one of those girls.
Yeah, we know them.
Why are you? What about those girls?
Nothing.
What about them? No. Let's talk about this.
Arundel mm-hmm. and Peterhouse.
Yes.
Are fine institutions.
But
that breed nothing but the highest caliber of women.
And then.
No butts. It's just straight compliments.
What? You saying Arundel girls don't have butts?
No.
You said no butts.
No. I said
you
no.
You said, but no butts. They don't have butts.
You see. You took it. But okay. You're in high school. You're competing in these V shows. You have dreams of one day becoming a star.
Yes.
When does this vague idea of a star start to take formation? And you're like, okay, this is the path I want to follow. And what do you start doing?
Wow. I had a number of moments like that. The first was probably when I was going through the Herald newspaper one day, mm-hmm. and there was an advert, and they were saying, you know, there's a TV show coming up and they have auditions for actresses. Mm-hmm. So I saw it, got the number, phoned, then they invited me to come and audition. I read the script for them, and it was for Studio 263.
263.
Exactly. And I remember it was Godwin, may his soul rest in peace. He's late now. But I remember sitting with him there. He gave me the script and he looked at me and he said, read it. And I read it and he burst into laughter when I finished reading it, because he was like, you've got something. Mm-hmm. And I was like, really? He's like, yeah, you've got something. So I was like, not in that accent, not in that voice, but you know what I mean? But then he's like, I want to work with you. Mm-hmm. And I just couldn't believe it. I remember getting home and saying, this is what's going on. But obviously, because there was no soapies or series, drama series in Zimbabwe, you know, telling my parents, they were like, where did you find these people? And why did you go there without our permission? Nobody was excited. I was like, no, I'm going to do this after school and whatever. But just that experience on its own was just fantastic. And I think also there's a power in the moment that somebody first believes in you. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of power in that moment. So that man, I wish he was still alive today so that I could thank him, mm-hmm. for how much life he spoke into my life and into my future by just saying, you've got something, kid. But, you know, the first time I heard that in my life. So, yeah. Okay. Yeah.
So what year was this?
Ooh, child, you want me to expose my age? This must have been probably about 2001, 2002.
Okay.
I think that's when 263 came out. Yeah, probably more 2002 actually, around then. Yeah.
And so you started shooting for 263?
Yes, I did.
Playing which character?
I was, you know what? So first I was cast to be the lead, whose name also happened to be Vimbai. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, I got the requirements and it basically required me to drop out of school. So it was like, I'm in Form 3 or Form 4. Nobody's dropping out of school for this, you know? So I was giving another character. Her name was Beauty, and she was a close friend to Vimbai's little sister called Tendai. Mm-hmm. And that was my character. So I played more of a supporting role, and it was something that allowed me to continue, you know, with the focus on my studies. So that was my character. A bit of a dry character, but I was there.
Mm-hmm. Tendai had a short hair, correct?
Yes. Yeah, exactly. She's a chubbyish little sister.
Yes, I remember her. Sister to Tino Katsande.
She was a sister to Vimbai. To Vimbai in the show.
Mm-hmm. Who was played by?
Who was played by Anne.
I'm mixing up. Okay. I remember. It was a while.
It was a while.
But yes, I remember 263.
Tino played Joyce.
Ah.
Yes.
If only you like ZBC could release a DVD box set.
I know, right? I think that would be phenomenal. You know, when 263 started, it was actually funded by USAID.
Yes, I remember. There were a lot of condom adverts.
Exactly. And it was supposed to be for HIV awareness. But mm-hmm. then it just got so big that it took on a life of its own and, you know, went on beyond their sponsorship or participation. Yeah.
So how many episodes did you end up doing for 263?
Oh, I have no idea. I was with Studio 263 for over a year.
Mm-hmm.
I would film at least twice a week.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
Was the money good? Like, were you able to ball out in high school?
For that age, yeah, man. I was balling. And I think that's when times were starting to get a little bit difficult in Zimbabwe. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I was able to help myself. You know what I mean? I didn't need to ask my parents for pocket money. And I was able to sustain myself. So okay. That was really cool, yeah.
And what is the effect of being on TV at school? Like, did people start treating you like a celeb? Were you popular?
No, nobody cared. Nobody cared. 30 people who cared were my brother's friends, and that's because they were making fun of me. Nobody cared.
Bastards.
Yeah, exactly.
But when I look back, like from that period, especially when we were growing up, there was a certain stigma. Yeah. Watching ZBC.
Yes, exactly.
So
exactly.
No one wanted to. Everyone watched ZBC.
Yeah.
But no one wanted to admit they watched ZBC.
Exactly. And then here I am, slap bang, prime time on ZTV. Nobody was about that life.
Yeah, Zimbabweans are weird people. So, what did you learn? Like, while on set, did you get any experience? Did the people that were on set teach you anything that you'd use now?
Oh, wow. You know, I learned so much. This production brought on an acting coach from Germany who was with us for a month. Wow. I learned, you know, 3/4 of the things I use today, I think started from those days, from those moments where he was telling you how to control your emotions, how to use your voice, how to, you know, project and all these fantastic things. It was an amazing experience. And I also learned how to be aware of cameras. You know, how to move, how to express myself on camera. That was all built then. It was all built then and it stuck with me and it never left me because I've never received any other training. That's the only, you know, official training I've ever received for television. So they did a good job. It was a great training ground. Very, very great training ground. Yeah.
Okay. So your year's up with 263. Why did they write you out of the script? Did you decide to leave?
I think at that point, 263 was also going through some changes. And because of the changes, it was just becoming too complicated for a young girl who was going to school, who had parents that she had to answer to, parents who also felt like this hobby shouldn't get too serious. So, you know, it just got to a point where I had to make a decision or I was forced to make a decision. And it was just like, well, man, I've got to let this thing go.
Okay.
So that's pretty much what happened. Yeah.
So... that falls to the wayside. Are you still trying to do drama or acting in high school, or do you put that dream to the side and focus on your studies?
In high school?
Mm-hmm.
Actually, I still wanted to do more, and I did go on to do more. I remember I was called for a short film for the Zimbabwe International Film Festival. But unfortunately, at that point, what happened is my best friend died in a car crash, and I was with her at the time that she died. Okay. And it just... threw things off course for me quite a bit. I went into a period of my life where I guess I just, you know, started looking for the meaning of life at an early age. So that shook me up. That changed me a lot. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So obviously being so close to such a tragic incident, it's going to take something out of you.
Yeah.
Is there something that helped you get over that pain and depression? Or was it just a gradual thing?
I think it was just a gradual thing. You know, when I look back at it now, it was just a gradual thing. It was, you know, the fact that life has to go on. There were no pity parties. I come from a pretty hardcore family where we're not, you know, being emotional is not really the permissible thing to do at home. So, you know, they kind of let me sulk for a week. And then after a week, it was like, yo, listen, you need to move on. So I think that just kind of forced me to move on. And so I moved on.
Okay.
Yeah.
So at this time, you what, Form 4, Lower 6?
This was beginning of Lower 6.
Lower 6, okay.
Yeah, beginning of lower 6.
So you do your A-levels.
Yeah.
Then what's next?
I do my A levels, and then at this point again, because, you know, kind of those years were a lot of self-discovery and figuring out what I love and what I like. And I discovered that I'm very passionate about politics. Not actual, you know, national politics per se, but, you know, when I read history books and saw what happened and saw people who changed the world, I loved those processes and I wanted to be a part of them. So I applied to UCT, the University of Cape Town, and that's where I went to study for university.
Okay, what did you study?
I studied politics, philosophy, and economics. Yeah. It was amazing. I loved it. I loved every minute of it. I loved, well, not every minute. I flunked a few economics courses, but I'm not even going to lie to you. It was rough. There were some rough moments. I think there's some course I actually never... is it econometrics? I don't know how to pronounce it. How do you pronounce it?
You're asking me.
Economics. Okay, well, I'm just putting it out there. You put me on blast now. Now people know I don't know how to pronounce it. But like, that thing, yeah? Oh, I failed it.
Okay. And while you're at UCT, are you still pursuing acting or presenting or something of that nature?
So whilst at UCT, I kind of became more of like an affirmative action activist, kind of like, like with the whole politics, I study politics and philosophy kind of vibe. Until I was spotted one fine day on the streets of Cape Town on Long Street. I know it's such a corny story. But I'm spotted and this lady is like, oh my goodness, you should model. And I'm like, oh really? I know. And she's like, no, I'm serious. And that's how I scouted to join a model agency and I started modeling. And first it was, you know, a gig here and a gig there. But before I knew it, my whole livelihood in university was being catered for by modeling. Yeah. So, but then I also kind of realized how difficult the industry was. So I was like, okay, let me focus on finishing. You know, so the moment I got my degree, I went straight into modeling.
Okay.
Yeah.
So what campaigns can our listeners Google and try and find?
Ooh, my favorite campaign is I did a global campaign for bio oil. That was wonderful. I enjoyed that thoroughly. So bio oil, then I did one for a telephone network called Zain. It was called Zain at the time. I think it's now currently Airtel. I did some awesome stuff with them. What else? So I did some cool stuff with Estee Lauder. Yeah.
Because I know Airtel is East Africa.
Yeah.
So they were outsourcing all their stuff.
Yes. So you'll find that quite a considerable amount of the world come to Cape Town to film because it's favorable, it's beautiful, it's cheaper. So yeah, so then they book talent from there as well. And yeah, so I was lucky. I remember I had a little like snappy second, not even a second, like nano, like worse than a split second in the movie Invictus.
Oh, really?
But it's one of those things where you're like, remember after 3 hours of the movie, i.e. the movie is an hour and a half long, but I'd be like, at the 3 hour mark, that's where you find me. I was there with Morgan Freeman. I was there.
Where, like in the stadium? Or?
There's a scene where they had a cocktail. I was there, damn it. I wish they had Snapchat in those days. He would have been all up on my snap.
I will find it. We'll find it.
No, trust me, I didn't make the cut. They cut me out so fast. But I was there. And I was paid 500 Rand for it.
That's good money, man.
Dude, well, for an hour looking at Morgan Freeman, I was grateful.
Okay. So things seem to be moving along quite steadily.
Yes.
So you graduate?
I graduate. I model. Parents are not happy.
Of course.
They demand a refund on their tuition because my parents are G like that. Then when I realized they were actually serious about this refund matter because it kept coming up, I was like, okay. They're like, why don't you come home and get a normal job like everybody else? So I'm like, oh, fine. So I go back home and try to figure it out. I never really got a job. I just tried to figure it out. But I was really frustrated and unhappy. And I was just like, no, I'm not the girl who's supposed to wear a suit to a banking hall every day. Like, I'm supposed to be on TV, damn it. And that's about the time that Munya had gone for his second round of Big Brother.
Okay.
And then Munya came out of Big Brother and he was a superstar. Like, everybody was bowing down to him. He was getting cash. Everybody knew who he was. So I was like, this Big Brother thing, let it come back around. I'll show them. And yeah, that's literally how it happened. Then I went into Big Brother and yeah.
So this is a conscious decision, like you actualize it, like you put it on the news, like I'm going to Big Brother.
Yeah, I just told myself, you know, I didn't tell anyone. It was a personal decision. Once I saw the thing was up on the website application was up, made sure I submitted that very speedily. Then they mailed me to say there's an audition, no problem, made sure everything was on for like, went to the audition. Made it. They call me to say you're in for the next round. You now have to travel to South Africa for medicals and whatever. Came to South Africa at that point. I think there was four of us and they had to bring it down to two. And then before I know it, they're calling me. They're like, yo, you've got a week to pack your bags and get into the house. Yeah.
All right. And all this while you're still with the day job?
No, that day job was long gone. Hey, the moment Big Brother called, I was like, deuces. baffling.
No, but I mean,
shocked.
Like you're applying and going through the process while you're still at the
yes,
job.
Yes, yeah. I'm using the internet to better my life.
Do you want to shout out your employers? Or?
No, I'm good.
Save for yourself from a lawsuit. Okay. So we've established that your parents are very hardcore.
Yeah.
So you've graduated. They said they want their money back. You're like, okay, fine. I'm going to get a job. You get the job. You're going to work every day. You're not happy.
Yeah.
And you come home like, Mom, Dad. So, you know that reality TV show? Yeah, I'm going to be on that. So I'm quitting my job. See you later. Bye.
Yeah.
Well, how did they take that?
Well, I think my mom was the more reluctant one, who was just like, well, are you sure about this? Is it safe? What is it? Then I'm like, because remember, Munya was everybody's favorite person. Mm-hmm. Then I was like, the thing Munya did, the moment I said Munya, oh, that's nice. And for some reason, my mom thought it was a job. My mom didn't realize that it was a competition. She actually thought it was a job. So she's like, oh, you got a job at Big Brother. Oh, no, please go. So I was like, okay, you know, I'm not going to be the one to be here, Clara. Clarifying it to it, I'm just gonna say thank you and keep it moving. Then my dad, on the other hand, was just like, please just don't embarrass us.
Mm-hmm.
That was it. That was all he said. He's like, you've got a bad temper, don't embarrass us.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now I'm trying to remember. When Big Brother first started, there was shower hour.
Yes.
Your season, was there shower hour?
There was, but that was the VIP edition where you had to pay money and watch it online.
It's gonna seem so sleazy.
It's so sleazy, but y'all still paid your money.
I never paid a cent. Yeah. Mnet does not see that. Okay, wait, let me not say that.
Exactly.
Yeah, let me not sell myself.
Please pay your subscription. Pay your subscription.
At this point, I'd like to remind DSTV and thank them for my complimentary subscription.
Exactly.
DSTV, giving you so much more. So I'm like that. That's what I'm trying to rationalize, like, because I know there's so like, from what you've said, your parents seem very reserved. They seem very old school.
Yeah.
How does, especially your dad? How would your dad take the fact, or did he know that there's some sleazy men paying extra to see you take a shower?
No, my dad just knew that ndekwana munya. So he was good. He was fine. It's like, it's that thing munya did. That's fine.
So like they didn't have any idea of like what went on in previous seasons.
No,
like
they
the
had
people
no
hooking
idea.
Up in the house and all that stuff.
No idea. It's only after I came out of the house. You know those outbursts that only happen when your parents or when somebody's upset with you. That like, I saw you drinking wine in the house, and you're just like,
Dosagant.
Exactly.
But so, okay, well, I guess if it wasn't an issue before, it wouldn't be an issue after, because it's not like anything scandalous happened.
Yeah, thank God.
Unless it was, and I
missed it. Thank God. No, you didn't miss anything. I was well behaved. I was about that, you know, government money. I needed that cash, man. Best behavior. You should talk about.
Shout out to the diamond boy.
Exactly.
All right. So you compete in Big Brother. How did you finish?
I got evicted the week before the finale.
So that's like
mofos, you evil people.
So, so that's pretty decent. That's pretty decent.
It's not decent. You allowed me to get close to the money just so you could let me go.
This portion of the interview, I'm gonna plead ignorance. Like I said, I don't really watch reality TV, so I literally.
But you knew about Shower Hour.
Yeah, because when Big Brother first started, I was a teenager. Of course, I knew about Shower Hour.
You still look like a teenager.
Sure, it's kind of insulting.
No, you're supposed to blush.
I don't know.
No, it's not a compliment for guys.
I don't know.
You're such a character.
So, yeah, but, you know, so I was, you discussed it in school. But yeah, that was then. This is now.
Yeah.
I remember once in a while, because at the time I was still living at home, so I'd come home, and my dad is a major Big Brother fan. In fact, we should probably call him up. He'd be like, oh my God, he's over by.
Oh, sweet.
But yeah,
shout out to your dad. I hope he didn't watch Shower Hour.
No, he does not know how to use a credit card. He does not know how to pay online. So
that's what you think.
I know this for a fact, because whenever he tries to buy something online, he calls me.
Okay.
But yeah, so that's where I'd see, like, whenever I'd come home and he'd be watching the highlights package or something. So that's why I call, like, drips and drabs.
Okay.
And I got to understand. I was like, no, she seems to be doing quite well.
Yeah.
Because you'd see people having meltdowns.
Acting a fool
on Big Brother.
Yeah.
And for the most part, you can. After a while, it becomes a pattern. You're like, yeah, you guys are just doing this to try to get votes.
Yeah. Well, some of it is genuine. Some people really are legit having meltdowns in there.
I can imagine, like, cabin fever is
real.
Yeah,
exactly.
Like, how did you handle that?
I honestly don't know. I look back at it and I'm not sure how I did it. I'm honestly not sure how I did it. I think I underestimate my willpower.
Mm-hmm.
I think I do. Because if you tell me about it now, I'll be like, I can't do it. But I somehow was able to do it. Because, you know, when they had us come back for the guest appearance, you know, in the final season of Big Brother, by day three, I was just like, listen, I'm done with you people. I'm done. Like, I don't need to be here.
Mm. So you weren't visualizing the money because you're already out. So
yeah, exactly.
The money from buy. Yes, okay, exactly. I'm good. Let's go.
Yeah. Pretty much. So.
Okay. No, that's impressive. I must say that. That's pretty impressive. So you get out.
Yes.
What's your first? The moment they announce that you are now out of the Big Brother house.
Yeah.
What is the first thought? What's step one in your long-term plan?
Step one in my long-term plan was always to get onto TV.
Mm-hmm.
I always wanted to get a radio show and get a TV show.
Okay.
So I actually started filming a TV show in Zimbabwe shortly after being evicted. Well, afterwards the season ended anyway. It's just that I didn't know enough at the time. So I it's impossible to make a TV show without any television experience. Well, a decent one anyway. So that dream kind of went on for like a couple of months. Then I was like, okay, let's be real. I'm just wasting my time here. So yeah.
Okay.
So that was that.
So plan A falls through?
Yeah, that falls through. Radio never happened. I tried to launch a perfume line. That never happened. I tried to get into music. That flopped. I went back to modeling. That didn't really work out. So basically, things were not working out for me for the longest time. Until I just woke up one day and I realized that I was in the wrong place.
Mm-hmm. That being now, Zimbabwe.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Now, let me tell you, I'm going to give you the exclusive, boo-boo. The exclusive. So, there's an award show called, I think it's called the Namas.
Mm-hmm.
Namas, right?
Mm-hmm, yeah.
That's there. So, I remember this particular year, it fell on my birthday. And they called me to present an award. And then... But the weeks preceding to it, I think they've got People's Choice categories and they'd been People's Choice in television. So I remember rounding up everybody I knew to nominate me and vote for me. So this was like there was a plan and a process to this, right? So daily, without fail, we were pushing like at least like 100, 150 votes, right? Mm-hmm. This is bearing in mind that at this particular time with the way things were in Zimbabwe, there weren't really any other TV personalities or you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So we're pushing. Then it came to the night of the awards and I went backstage because I had to present an award. And one of the people, the organizers of the event, pulled me aside and said, oh, I heard it's your birthday. Happy birthday. Then the guy says, I've got a birthday present for you. I'm like, what's the present? Then he goes, no, I can't tell you. Then he goes, oh, okay, actually, you won an award. So I'm like, oh, what did I win? He goes, oh, you know, the TV, whatever, TV personality, whatever. So I'm like, oh, wow. So I'm like super excited. So I present my award. Then he's like, go and sit somewhere, you know, where you can easily get out. I stick around for the whole show. And they actually chose to completely remove the category from the award show. So then after the show, I go to this guy and I'm like, what happened? They didn't even announce the category. So it's not even like somebody else won. The category was removed. Then the guy was like, yeah, no, they felt like you didn't deserve to win it. So they canceled the category. So I'm like, oh. So I just remember I never told anybody. Yeah.
There's so many red flags being raised
right
now.
Yeah, well, if you look back to, I think it was 20, it must have been 2012 or 20, must have been 2012. If you look back to the Namas of that year, there was no TV category. It was removed, but it's a consistent category every year.
Really? It wasn't. Was it there this year? I don't remember. I don't recall seeing it this year because I covered them this
year. Maybe it wasn't there. Okay. But it was like promoted, Sha. Like as in we voted.
And they were charging people for these SMSs.
I can't remember. No, it was an online vote. It was a free online vote.
Free online, okay.
But so my thing is, it's not that somebody else won it. Like, why was the whole category removed? Do you get what I mean?
Why nominate you in the first place then?
Exactly. So that was like a thing, you know. And I remember after that, I was upset, but I couldn't say anything to anyone. And then there was a lady who wasn't such a good friend of mine, but like was an acquaintance who I was supposed to drive home with. And I just remembered like venting to her. So I didn't say why I was venting or why I was upset, but I just said something along the lines of, you know, I don't think this is where I belong. I don't think I'm supposed to be here. And this lady is like, no, you have to, you can't make it anywhere else. This is you, boo. Like, this is it for you. So you need to figure out how to make it work. And I'm like, I just don't think my calling is to, if I'm supposed to make an impact on this industry, I don't think I'm supposed to do it this way. Mm-hmm. I think I'm supposed to do it another way. And she was just like, no, but this is like, this is you. Literally, she shut me down. She was like, this is you. This is it. Don't, I hate it. She actually said, I hate it when people talk about they need to leave the country and whatever. Don't be those people. Like, I hate it. It's annoying. You just need to stay here and like fight the good fight, basically is what she said to me. And it just, like, I remember I got home and I cried. I cried for like a good 24 hours. Then after crying, I just started praying. I started praying, I prayed for a few days until I realized, you know what, Vimbai, this is not where you belong. The reason why things are not working out is because this is not where you belong. Okay, so where do I belong? Go to Joburg. Because I was super prayerful at this point. Go to Joburg. So I'm like, okay. I remember telling my mom, I'm going to go to Joburg for a few weeks. She's like, what are you going to go and do there? She says, no, I need to figure myself out. But right now, like, something is telling me to go to Joburg. I need to go. And she was just like, this is ridiculous. This is stupid. What's wrong with you? You're lazy. Just get a job like normal people. It went back to that, right? She's like, Big Brother came and went, and it's now time to get a job. And I'm just like, and I will if this doesn't work out, but I've got a hunch about something. And I remember there's one gig I did. I can't remember what the gig was. There's one gig I did, and I used the money from that gig to buy myself a ticket to go to South Africa. I was able to crash with a friend for a couple of weeks. During those couple of weeks, guess what? I get a phone call from Mnet saying, yo, one of our execs saw you in the mall. Are you in Joburg? Yes, I'm in Joburg. Wonderful. We need to see you on Friday. Okay. Go there Friday. They say we've got a new show coming up. It's called Star Gist. The audition is on Wednesday. So I'm like, okay, Wednesday. Oh, boo. Wednesday, I went, had my makeup done professionally, had my hair done, bought a new dress, wore high heels, everything. Walked up into that set, read the hell out of that script. And I got a call 24 hours later saying, girl, listen, you just got yourself a job. That's how that played out.
Okay. Well, look at you. Look at you.
Peace signs to those who can't see me. So, yeah. So that's pretty much, that was my journey.
All right. Yeah, it's weird. Like, we've done a number of interviews with a lot of successful people, and I've listened to a couple. It's always, it's the same formula. Like, if you really focus on your goal and you work towards it and no matter how many hurdles come your way, and if you keep pushing, the universe will conspire to give you what you want if you're willing to work for it.
Yeah.
And I think that's where a lot of people fall short. Like, after like failure number two or three, like, you know what? Okay, let me go for the safe option.
Do you know what the other thing is? I think as human beings, we like to focus on where we are being rejected. We don't like to turn and look at where we could be accepted. That's our biggest weakness. And so many people focus on that. And especially with the way things are going in Zimbabwe right now, everybody's focusing on, this is where it's going wrong. Oh my gosh, we're screwing up here. What about just looking the other way and being like, okay, well, there's a guy called Winky D who's doing really well. What is it that he's doing that's making things work out? Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. How can we replicate this formula so that we can grow it and make it a bigger thing or whatever it is? So I think for me, that's probably the biggest gem that I've learned in my life is now I know, and I mean, I'm also a very God-fearing person, but now I know that if I'm being rejected somewhere, it's because it's time for me to move to a different place. So, okay. Yeah.
All right. So you've successfully relocated.
Yes.
So to speak, you're now on Stargist.
Yeah.
Momentum starts picking up.
Yes.
So now have you readjusted your plan? What's the next step? After you've got Stargist, are you thinking, okay, I've got this, I need to start doing this? Or
Stargist was just a shock to the system. Mm-hmm. You know, I'd never hosted on TV before. Everything I'd done was live emceeing, you know, events and stuff. So getting it right on TV was a process. It was such a process. And, you know, on a daily show, it was difficult. It was so tough. There was no time to think about anything else. Mm-hmm. It was just, I was fighting with myself every day. It's like, you know, an athlete who's trying to like beat their record or whatever. Yeah. It was literally that, fighting with myself every day to try and get better and better before I could even think about the next thing. And literally, as I'm, you know, on this journey, stumbling, trying to figure it out along the way, is when I get a call from Nigeria to start, you know, I get a call, hey, we're doing the first ever Africa Magic Viewers Choice Awards. You're the host. What? So, yeah, so that's been my life pretty much.
Okay, okay. So to date, let me see if I got this right, because I know you do Stargist.
Yes.
There's obviously the AMVCAs.
Yes.
I know you're doing SA Tourism. Got yes. A few campaigns there. Obviously, a few modeling gigs here and there.
Yes.
See.
I did a show for Techno, the mobile. Do we have Techno in Zimbabwe?
No.
Okay. Techno is a huge mobile brand in East and West Africa. Mm-hmm. So I did a music reality show for them called Techno on the Stage, which is like Idols pretty much.
Oh yes, okay.
Yes, yeah.
Okay, I think that's on the what's it called? It's the East Africa. I think the Go TV bouquet.
Yes, exactly. Yes. And it's on Maisha.
Ah,
yeah.
You were telling me that you're working on another show that's going to be airing internationally.
Yes, I'm so excited. Oh, this is the first time I'm breaking beyond African borders. Okay. So my passion is travel. Mm-hmm. I love to travel, and one thing I've noticed about travel, or the way African travel is portrayed, is that we're very stereotyped. When the rest of the world thinks about traveling in Africa, or when they think about Africa, there's certain images, you know, constant images that always come to mind. Mm-hmm. And I looked at that and I just felt like, but you know, yes, it's a reality. I'm not going to deny that there's certain things happening on the continent that are being reported in the news, but a lot of those things don't speak to the majority of our daily realities.
Yeah.
So I was like, no, man, but why doesn't the world see Africa for what it is? Why can't I show, you know, that life is normal, but why can't I also show that actually beyond life being normal, there's some people who are living very fabulous lives. Let me do that by traveling around the continent and showcasing the best that we have to offer. So that's how Miss Vimbai Travels was birthed. And that's scheduled to broadcast in the US in April. Mm-hmm. And then followed by the UK. And then after that, I'll bring it back home to broadcast on DSTV.
Oh, so yeah. How many episodes are you planning?
13 episodes. 13, okay. Yeah, that'll be the first season. Rounding up the first season now and going straight into the second season. I'm not going to stop. I'm going to keep on going.
Look at you.
I know. The hustle is real.
Which stations is it airing in America and UK?
I am not yet in a position to disclose. But if you just keep an eye on the media, on my social media as well, at @_Vimbai across all social media networks, you'll definitely get the news as soon as it happens.
Okay. Yeah. Look at you doing big things. So mm-hmm. Acting, any plans to get back into acting?
You know what? I realized that Nollywood is a huge industry. It's massive. I mean, I have friends who shoot 8 movies a month. You know, that's Nollywood. Yeah. So I just made a conscious decision that it's not my core acting. My core right now is hosting. Mm-hmm. So I said, okay, this is something I really love. So because I love doing it, let me just wait for the right scripts to come around.
Okay.
So what I usually do is I look for the scripts that are really different and out of the box. So I look for characters that are not the usual characters that you see in Nollywood. So I wouldn't be playing anybody's evil stepmother. I wouldn't be playing a witch. I wouldn't be playing a mistress. I look out for really unique roles, and mm-hmm. those are the ones I take on. So I've got a movie that's premiering in cinemas this March in Nigeria. Okay. It's called For the Wrong Reasons. And that was a fantastic, fantastic role. I'm not sure how much I'm allowed to tell, but all I can say is that I made a very convincing junkie.
Okay.
Yeah.
Alright, so for fans outside of Nigeria, mm-hmm. what's the distribution model going to be? Do you know what the distribution model is going to be? Like, is it going to be available online?
It's probably going to be available on, there's a lot of online platforms for Nigerian films. Yeah. So I'm pretty sure the first port of call will be Iroko.
Mm-hmm.
So I would recommend that everybody looks out for Iroko. Once it's out in cinemas, once it's done with that circuit, it probably will be available on Iroko for streaming and for download.
Okay. Yeah. Great. We'll be looking on eagerly to see what else Ms. Fimbai has in store. You know, we are very proud.
Thank you. We are very proud. Thank you. I appreciate it. Thank you for taking your time out today to come and speak to me. I really appreciate it. I know I was late. I'm going to put myself on blast. I was
mm-hmm,
late
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
and I owe Phil.
Mm-hmm.
But mm-hmm. when I pay him back, y'all will know that mm-hmm. I've paid him back. Mm-hmm. I'm going to pay him back like that double for his trouble.
Mm-hmm. So, as you know, the title of this podcast is Two Broke Twimbos. Are you going to be paying me back in cash?
Kind, ka. I don't know. Look out for the alerts.
Oh, okay. I'll be there. I'm turning on all the alerts.
Exactly.
My PayPal,
exactly.
My EcoCash, my Cash Send.
Yeah, exactly. No, you never know, man. Mm. Alert could come in anytime. Okay. Anytime. I'm not telling you if it's a debit or a credit alert, but there'll be an alert, no doubt.
Oh, yeah. So you're obviously back in South Africa for a specific reason.
Yes.
You're telling me you're planning on traveling to Cape Town. What's going on there?
So I'm filming Miss Vimbai Travels,
mm-hmm.
and this time we're in partnership with SA Tourism.
Okay.
So they've brought in a number of people from Nigeria who they feel are influencers in that market.
Yeah.
So we're with MI, mm. Praise, OCU KJ, mm-hmm. D Black, he's from Ghana. exactly. So they're all part of the group, and we're here and we're going to do a bunch of cool activities in Cape Town. We're going to go for the polo, the Veuve Clicquot mm-hmm. polo that they do there. So yeah. So we're here. Everybody else is here to hang out and have fun. I'm here to work. I'm here to film the show, just so you guys can get the best possible content. I want people to watch the show and be proud and be like, damn, did she get the people who make the Kardashians to make the show? I want it to be on those kinds of levels. Okay. So we're going all out. I mean, we've got private jets in the show.
What?
We've got helicopters. We've got Bentleys. Oh, it's luxurious,
so,
yeah.
Do you guys need like an extra camera hand, you know?
Sure,
know
of course we do. Yeah?
And push trolleys and stuff. And
you want to come?
Yeah.
You know. Okay, cool.
I'm cheap.
So
I'm
going to send you a bus ticket to Cape Town. Hopefully by the time you get there, we won't be finished.
you try and help people out, and this is what they do.
This is what they do, right? On a serious note, if you are interested in television, let's talk. Let's talk offline.
Oh, definitely. Yeah. We'll do that.
Cool.
Okay. No, we appreciate your time, Ms. Vimbai.
Thank you. It's nice to be here.
Please tell our listeners where they can get hold of you, where can they follow your work.
Oh, well, you guys can get a hold of me on Twitter and Instagram. The handle is at Miss, M-I-S-S underscore Vimbai, V-I-M-B-A-I. And it's the same handle for Snapchat. I just recently started snapping, so that's going well. My YouTube channel is Vimbai Mutinire.
Okay, great.
And my website is www.missvimbai.com.
Hey, guys, you see that she's got a website?
That's right.
Unlike other celebs.
Ooh, shade.
We appreciate that. And obviously, Dan was not here. I don't know if you know my co-host, Dan. Danny that guy,
of course I do. He's my favorite colored person. He's colored, right? No? Can you edit that out? He's not? Love you, Danny.
That's hilarious.
I've never met him in real life.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I'll be sure to pass.
So wait, he's not?
I actually don't really believe colored's a real race. But that's it's more of a culture. But his dad is black, his mother's white. She's from Russia.
Oh, you see, so I'm right.
Mm-hmm. Yes, technically.
Yeah, he's awesome. Mm-hmm. He's got that yellow skin.
Yeah. Then she's calling you a yellow boy. Once again, the light-skinned bastard has struck again.
Yeah. Although I'm not into the light-skinned guys, but I notice them. Who wants to date a light-skinned guy now? Busy competing with everybody on these streets. I beg, let my guy just sit quietly. I prefer dating ugly guys. They can just sit quietly, no disturbances. You don't need to worry about who's hitting them up. Even if their phone rings at 3 a.m., you're like, it must be business. Must be business.
This interview just went left so quickly.
Could I just say, I take that all back. I don't prefer dating ugly. I was joking. My boyfriend is a very good-looking guy. Very good looking guy.
Oh man, that was funny. Okay.
Even with the lights on.
So on that note,
yes,
we can end this episode. Guys, please don't forget to follow us on Twitter, like us on Facebook, subscribe on iTunes. Don't forget to rate and review on iTunes. We really need that for our search algorithm. And yes, you'll be happy to know this is the first interview.
Yeah.
Post us winning best online media.
Oh, by the way, shout out to that. Yeah. Do you guys have a horn or something? What do we do?
bullet. Yes.
Sorry, I had
to
throw that in there.
Yes. I'll have you know, this is my third award in a year.
Oh, look at you. Oh, really? In 1 year?
It's a humbling experience.
Oh, my gosh. Look at you going all Kanye West on us. Did you thank your mom, your dad?
I did. The funny thing is, they did the same thing to me they did to you. So, the way the... I'll show you the order after the interview.
Yeah.
But they announced like all the big awards.
Yeah.
The beginning of the night, like Album of the Year, Male Artist, Female Artist. So, me and Dan are sitting like, yo, I thought like... Ours is a media award. Why wouldn't this be the first thing you get out of the way so you can focus on the big awards? So they get done with all the big artist awards. Then the ZBC guys start picking up their cameras.
So you're like, oh, hell no, not on my time. I hope you started a riot.
Then after almost everyone has left and all the garbage time performances have been done, they're like, finally.
We are on to the media awards. We'd like to...
Vexed. Like it was a Vex award. Have you heard of... Let me tell you. Have you heard about Vex money? Let me teach you about Vex money. Mm. Vex money is the money that you carry as a girl. Mm-hmm. If you're going on a date with a guy, you need to have Vex money. So that when that guy vexes you, you can just say, screw you, I don't need you no more. And you can get into a cab and you have money to pay for yourself. You don't need to wait for someone else.
That is sage advice. I keep telling my sisters, ladies, do not go on these dates.
No, you need at least enough to get home.
Do not go to these Metro FM awards in Durban or these AMVCAs in Lagos without your emergency stash. Exactly. Because Lord knows what's going to happen. Like, he might change his mind.
Yeah.
You know, these guys are shady.
True.
They might ask something that you're unwilling to give them.
Preach.
And then they'll be like, no, it's fine. It was there. And what you going to do?
Hallelujah. Huh?
Now you're at the bus stop in high heels and a cocktail dress.
That's right.
Trying to get home.
Amen. I mean,
Yes, sister. Get Vex money.
Vex money is needed. Okay, I've wasted enough of your time for one day.
This is a very good interview. This was a great interview.
Yay!
We appreciate the time. So guys, don't forget, follow, like, subscribe, zip it up and zip it out. We are out.
Really?
We broke.
That's right.
Studio 263.
Well, it's the place to be. There's no other place me I would rather be. Timungua, who paid you, who no like it at? Timungua, who no stress at? But I know, let you know, your life is what you make it. I know you were strong and you can take it. This is the place where you wanna be. Yo, it's Studio 263.
263.
263.
263. 263.
Yeah, this is the place
where you wanna be. Studio
263.
263. 263. Yeah, this is the place where you wanna be. Studio 263.
263. 263.